Hello there, a very good morning. You're watching Proactive London, and joining us now is Mark Hood here from Coro Energy, because plenty to discuss. We're going to talk about the situation with the debt restructure and extension on what's happening there. I know you've just got back from the Philippines, so we'll talk about your trip, the Duyung progress as well, and your renewables portfolio a little bit later on, as well as what's happening with Italian gas too. So plenty on the agenda today. But let's first of all talk about the economics and explain to us what's happening with this debt restructure and extension situation. And a very good morning to you, Mark.
Good morning. That's a long introduction. I think the first thing we need to talk about, really, as you say, is the debt. Obviously, it's been hanging over for quite some time now, and has certainly been the cause of quite a lot of chatter on some of the websites. So we're kind of well aware of it. So really, we just want to give a little bit of an overview in terms of where we are. Now, the debt was formed for the Duyung asset in the first place, which obviously our Indonesian asset. The general crux of it is that we've extended the maturity by another 2 years, which brings us into April 2024. But we've also done a few other advantage points for us in terms of removing those cash interest payments until we get to the point of maturity, by which point we'll be at some point within the development of the asset, or we will have gone through the process of selling. So ultimately, it's a bit of a win-win for everybody. We get to be able to move forward. We get to be able to release everything from the debt. And we don't really have to then focus on that and making those payments as we move forward every year as we have been to date. So it's a fantastic move forward for us, and really will allow us to get the business to move forward.
All right. Well, talking about moving forward, let's talk about this relaunching of your Italian gas portfolio amidst this higher gas price situation that we're currently in. And this is following the termination of a sale agreement last week, Mark.
It was. So obviously, the gas market has changed quite significantly across Europe. And I think it's only fair that we just take a second to just remind ourselves of the plight that we are going through at the moment and the energy crisis, and really what's causing that. And obviously, our thoughts and feelings go out to all of those that are involved. Ultimately, it has pushed the gas price up in Italy, and we've, from an investor perspective, we have to take that into account and actually look at what it is we're doing in Italy and really start to reevaluate those assets that we have. So yes, we have pulled out of that sales agreement with Dubai Energy Partners Incorporated, the American company. Now, the background to that deal was that we were selling the assets while the gas price was incredibly low. With the increase in price, and we're now seeing it, and I think within one of the recent publications, we've said a 700% increase in the price. The peak price of gas recently within Italy went above 2.5 euros per cubic meter, which is unheard of in the realms of where we were looking before. Today, it's still sitting at well over a euro, and again, a significant increase to where we were before. So we have a large portfolio in Italy. Things have changed. Like I say, we aren't now in the process of selling it. We've taken it off the market. And that comes on the back of the upturn. And then really, we start to look at the gas prices that come into play and really what it means for us. Now, from our perspective, it's already an operating field, and we're producing a small amount of gas, around 6,000 cubic meters per day, from the Rapignano field. We're in the process of doing the 10-year maintenance package on the Solaro field, which we expect to have complete, well, really by the end of March or the beginning of April. That will then bring in another 18,000 a day. We're then also looking at some of the other assets that we have out there as well, at the Bezzecca field, the Casa Tiberi, San Alberto. Ultimately, we get to the point where we've got a significant increase in reserves available to us. And if we just look at San Alberto, for example, that's another 75 standard cubic meters a day. So, you know, again, once that comes into operation, we then will have a much more increased portfolio there. And that will obviously then be able to cover our G&A. We'll be able to use those funds to then re-inject within the Southeast Asia portfolio of renewables. So it's a very strong story. We're very excited about it. Obviously, we've got lots going on out there. We've said before, it's now, even as it is today, we're now producing approximately 5 million worth of free cash flow just across those two assets that are producing. So, you know, again, it's a huge thing for us. We get to be able to move forward, and it provides additional capital for those additional projects within Vietnam and the Philippines.
All right. And let's talk about the progress in general for Duyung.
So Duyung is moving ahead. Obviously, COVID slowed things down quite significantly, and Conrad, the operator, have been working very closely with the off-takers within Southeast Asia, and obviously in Singapore, as well as SKK Migas, looking at the different options for where we can actually sell that gas and what the evacuation routes are. Now, things are progressing incredibly well. We've obviously heard from our other counterparties on the PSC over recent days where they've made their announcements. We're looking at, or we're expecting to see progress on the GSA within the next, well, within the next very short period. So, you know, we're looking at within the next month.
All right. Okay. Well, we'll definitely catch up then in a month. It's great to get sort of the latest on that. And your renewables portfolio in general. So can you maybe just summarize it for us? And as I mentioned, you're back fresh from the Philippines yourself.
Yeah. So let me just touch upon the Vietnam stuff first, because there's some pretty good progress going on over there as well. So we've obviously gone through the process. Vietnam has actually opened up today for travel, and we're planning on getting out there within the next couple of weeks. So again, that's another huge step forward. We're in the process at the moment of going through the final stages of negotiation on that first PPA for the pilot project. Now, that in itself is key. Once we've got that first project done, we've got that proof of concept. We're already speaking to various different funders for the rest of the projects and being able to provide the project project funding for that. So again, that's that first step. Once we've done that, we can then look at the next part and the next part and the next part, and then really enlarge that to be in the 150 megawatts worth of rooftop solar that we always said that we were going to do. We're also looking at a few other projects in Vietnam, as we always are, looking at various different options there. But the focus at the moment is really on those first projects, getting that pilot organized, getting that PPA signed, and then really being able to get that in operation as quickly as possible.
Okay. And the remainder of the portfolio?
So the Philippines is then obviously the big thing. So, excuse me. We were out there, Mike has been out there, our COO has been out in the Philippines looking at those 100 megawatt wind and the 100 megawatt solar project. We've made significant progress in country while we've been able to be there. The local guys and the local team that we have in country have obviously done a fantastic job supporting where we are and moving things forward. And it's been great to see that even through the pandemic, those relationships with the likes of the Department of Energy, with NGCP, the grid operator, and the local government units and all those other kind of things that come into play have still been kept fresh. So when we arrived in, we could get straight into the nuts and bolts. We could talk about the detail of the project very openly with them to actually see where we were going and see what we're doing to progress them. So while we were there, we've met with the local people, we've gone down to site, we've done site reviews, we've got equipment in progress at the moment. So that's currently being shipped for the wind measurement campaign. We expect to see that happening within the next month or so when it actually arrives on site. We can then actually then start to share some significant data from that as well, just in terms of where we are and what's happening. Obviously, it all comes down to making sure we've got those permits in place. The government units, both federal and local, are working extremely closely with us. The local government units, the local mayor, the local barangay chiefs, we're all working very closely, and everything is just now clicking nicely into place. So it's fantastic to see that we are now getting that progress that we always said we were going to do.
All right. Well, great to get a catch up. We'll do these more. Mark Hood from Coro Energy here on Proactive.
Thank you very much, Katie.